Well, hello. How you guys doing? Good to see you guys. Thanks for inviting me. My name is Kevin Wilmont, and I'm a filmmaker and a professor at Kansas University. And I'm sorry for anybody that's from Missouri or from K-State. I sincerely apologize from the very get go here. But I'm from Junction City, Kansas. How many of you guys know Junction City? Anybody know Junction City? Yes, indeed. Born and raised in Junction City. I always say that because that takes the K-State thing. And that doesn't help with Missouri so much, but helps with the K-State thing. I guess I'm here to kind of do something completely different for you guys, in a sense. And I'm a storyteller, really, more than anything. And I like to always talk about, you know, how the event in my childhood that really influenced me in my filmmaking career, you know. I loved to play with Army men as a kid. The guys know what I'm talking about. You know, I was probably about 10 years old, and I was playing with Army men on the floor, my living room. It was a weekday, and my mother is there, and my father is there, and there's a neighborhood man from down the street who was there, and they're talking, having fun, watching TV. And a flash comes across the television. Martin Luther King has been assassinated in Memphis. My mother jumps up. She starts screaming and hollering and going crazy. My father, my brother, my older brother, they get up. The old man from down the street, he gets up. My mother's totally out of control, screaming, hollering, crying. She goes out on the front porch. She's screaming, totally out of control. My father, this neighborhood man, and my big brother, they finally calm her down, and they get her back in the house, and it's like, sit her down. And I turn to my big brother, and I say, "Who's Martin Luther King?" And I was that kid in grade school that was the current events kid. So, you know, when I would be in school, it would be like, yes, Kevin. Hurricane Camille happened last night. Oh, well, thank you very much, Kevin. Thank you very much. So clearly this was a huge event on the television. And so I was in fourth grade. I went to school the next day. And I said, yes, Kevin, Martin Luther King was assassinated last night. And my teacher said, we won't be talking about that. I was like, what? Wow. Because that's the first time that had ever happened, because I always, you know, my mother made us watch the news, and I always went to school the next day and talked about what was going on. But she said, we won't be talking about that. And what do you think happens to a kid when you're 10 years old and somebody tells you, we won't be talking about that? That's all you want to talk about after that, right? And that's what happened to me. When she said, we won't be talking about that, that's all I've been talking about ever since. And that's the thing that probably influenced my filmmaking career probably more than anything, is I like to make films that challenge us, to make films that make you see the other person's point of view, to kind of make you kind of have to rearrange your ideas about the world you live in different kind of ways. And so, you know, I grew up in Junction City, a long way from Hollywood, but I was able to find a way to kind of learn how to write screenplays. I went to NYU, first started with a little small school in Salina, Kansas called Marymount College. Anybody know Marymount College in Salina, Kansas? Yeah, great school. And in fact, I'll talk about this film a little bit later, but there was a play that I was in at Marymount that ended up being a Spike Lee movie. Is that crazy? A play at Marymount College, a little Catholic school, mainly white folks, and it ends up being a Spike Lee movie. How the heck does that happen? I'll tell you about that in a minute. So I try to make these films that change our ideas about things. And So one of the things I've always been is it's really kind of a history geek, a history nut. And I started my screenwriting career working with a buddy of mine. His name is Mitch Bryan. He lives here in Kansas City. We wrote a screenplay called Shields Green and the Gospel of John Brown. John Brown, of course, was the famous abolitionist. And Shields Green was a slave who was with him at Harper's Ferry, who was captured with John Brown and was hung with John Brown. And the only way to really understand John Brown is to look at John Brown from the point of view of a slave. Because, you know, when we were kids, we were always taught, well, you know, John Brown was crazy. Really? The guy owning the slave is not crazy, but the guy trying to free the slaves is crazy. Think about that one for a minute. And so that was the point of view of our film, Shields Green and the Gospel of John Brown. And we sold it to 20th Century Fox, big sale. Chris Columbus, the guy that did Home Alone, Mrs. Doubtfire, he bought the film, he bought the script. I always thought he'd have John Brown doing this, but I was really, really worried about that. That would not be good. So he bought the screenplay, but they never made the film, and probably because they wanted Paul Newman to play John Brown, but he refused to work for Rupert Murdoch. I can understand that. They wanted Harrison Ford to play John Brown, but he didn't want to play that old. He's old enough now, but at that time, this was about 25 years ago now, he didn't want to play that old. You know, he still wanted to be 50 and have those 20-year-old women in movies, you know? You know how they do. So that movie didn't happen, but it launched my screenwriting career. And so I worked in Hollywood for about 10 years writing various screenplays for different people. Then I also started making my own films, because one of the things you quickly find out about Hollywood is not about your personal vision. So I started making my own films, and one of the things that really got me frustrated with Hollywood was every time I would go in for a meeting at a Hollywood company, and I'd say, yeah, I'd like to make this movie about this part of history, this certain area of history, and they say, well, you know, Amistad didn't do well. You know, Beloved didn't do well. When they say do well, that means they didn't make a lot of money. So I said, well, you know, I got these ideas about slavery, different things, and I think I'm going to make a movie about, well, what if the South had won the Civil War? What if the South had won the Civil War and slavery was still going on today? Woo! Yeah, I think that'd be a good idea. So I made this film called CSA, The Confederate States of America. And it's about what happens when the South wins the Civil War. They lose the Union. The North loses at Gettysburg, and the French and the British come in and they help the Confederates, and they win. And slavery continues until today. So let me show you a clip from the film. So the film is from the point of view of, you're in the CSA, no longer the USA. You're at home in the CSA. You're watching television in the CSA. And you get to see this documentary about their history from the point of view of Confederate television. And this is one of their commercials.
A man fills many roles in his lifetime. Provider, protector, master of the house. As a father, you have a vital role in your family's life. They depend on you to be there. We help to make sure you can fulfill that promise because, no matter what they call you, at the end of the day, you know you're just dad.
So what was interesting about that, of course, I ticked off a whole lot of folks, which is kind of what the idea was. But what was interesting about that commercial in particular, Confederate Family Insurance, when I wrote it was Confederate life insurance, but I had to change it for legal reasons to Confederate family, because still today there is a Confederate life insurance company. And so I made this film to kind of protest the Confederate flag flying over the state house in South Carolina, and the fact that you see Confederate flags all over the place. You know, when you're driving, you see Confederate flags on people's cars all the time. And you say to yourself, you know, my father, I have a kind of a weird background. My father was born in 1898. My father, not my grandfather, my father was born in 1898. He was 60 years old when I was born. So my father was born only 30 years or so after slavery. Not my grandfather, my father. He was born in Mississippi in 1898. He had no rights anybody had to respect. He had, you know, one time he told me they were so poor, they had to eat roots out of a tree. And so I remember as a kid, I was drawing this Confederate flag one time. He said, "What are you doing, son?" I said, "I'm drawing this flag I saw in the movie. Dad, it's really cool." He said, "That's the flag of slavery, son." I said, "Really? Nothing that I'd seen on TV ever said that was the flag of slavery." So I tried to make a film that made people kind of have to rethink this thing that had become normal in our everyday life. I remember I liked the Confederate flag, you know, because nothing in my experience had told me that the Confederate flag meant slavery. At school, they said, "Well, you know, the Confederate flag is about industrial and agriculture. That's what the war was about, states' rights." I said, "Well, what right were they concerned about?" "Well, the right to own slaves." Oh, forgot about that part, right? So it made me kind of rethink everything when I made this film, because I thought, well, in many ways, the South did win the Civil War. It's not the Mississippi Board of Education case that desegregates the schools. It's the Topeka, Kansas Board of Education case that desegregates the schools. So when the South lost, they didn't change their way of life. They changed the Northern way of life, where I teach KU. KU was segregated. Was segregated until Wilt Chamberlain shows up to play basketball in Lawrence. That's 1955. 1955, black women cannot try on dresses on Mass Street. They cannot go to movie theaters. It is a totally different, so how, my kids went to Free State High. So how did the Free State go from the legend, the legacy of John Brown to then a segregated state? Well, it must be because the South won. Well, they lost on the battlefield, but they clearly won in their attempt to hold on to their way of life. So the America kind of has three foundings. Obviously, 1776, then 1865. And then really the Civil Rights Movement, and America's reborn again. And it seems to me that what I learned from making CSA, that we have this constant battle going on in American life, that partly we're the CSA and partly we're the USA. The USA is where we celebrate freedom, we increase freedom, we want people to have more freedoms. The CSA is where we restrict freedom, we deny freedom, we try to limit people's freedoms. The Civil Rights Movement brings black folks and then kind of inspires women and inspires gay folks and inspires all these other people that then want their rights as well. And we still struggle with that. With every election day, we of course see the map and you see it's half and half, isn't it? So it's a constant battle, this CSA, USA thing. And I think part of our problem is that we aren't honest enough about our own history to kind of be able to deal with that part of it, right? One of the guys that played in my film, CSA, he was a vice president at Time Warner in Kansas City. And he was an actor as well. And he was in not just my movies, but other people's movies as well. And they were celebrating him in Kansas City at a media conference. And they were showing clips from his movies to kind of honor him. I wasn't there. and they showed a clip from CSA. Probably shouldn't have done that with me not being there, because he was fired from his job as a vice president at Time Warner. And, you know, we wrote letters to Time Warner. What's crazy is IFC Films was the distributor of Time Warner, of our film CSA, and there's the parent company of IFC Films is Time Warner. So Spike Lee presents our film. He saw my film right before we got to Sundance, and he presents the film. So we told Time Warner, but they still fired him. And I tried to explain to them, it's like, well, you know, that guy, Hannibal Lecter, in those movies, he's actually not eating those people. You know, that's all acting. That's all acting. This is just show, folks. But the problem was, is that, you know, CSA is, some people call it the most controversial film maybe ever made. And I think they're probably right, because we can deal with sex. We can deal with violence. We can deal with all kind of extreme things in American life. But we have a really, really, really difficult time talking about race. And that is the third rail. And that's the thing that gets people fired and no explanation can be given to save their career, right? It's pretty heavy that way. Let me show you another film I made. This is a scene from my film, Jayhawkers. And Jayhawkers is about Wilt Chamberlain when he was recruited to play basketball at KU in 1955. And what's really interesting about the story is that, again, as I mentioned, Lawrence was segregated, and KU was pretty much segregated. It was not officially segregated. By 55, it was just socially really segregated. And Chancellor Franklin Murphy, very progressive guy, he kind of figured out that if I get Wilt Chamberlain here, I can really kind of change the whole cultural reality of maybe this area. And that's what he did. So Fog Allen was the coach. And Fog Allen wasn't against, you know, he was, Wilt, everybody wanted Wilt to play. He was like the first superstar of basketball. So the whole country was recruiting him. And Wilt wanted to play for Fog Allen because Fog Allen was, you know, really the first really great basketball coach. And so they all wanted Wilt. And so when they got Wilt, you know, it was like, this is a major thing. And the whole country's focused on KU. And they had one other black player. They had two other black players. But the black player on the team before Wilt, his name was Maurice King. And what's interesting, his grandson is on the Baylor team that'll be playing KU tonight. And Maurice King had to deal with being alone, the black person on the team. And so one of the things you'll hear in the scene is that when they would travel out of town on games and so forth, of course it was segregated. And before a home game, Coach Allen would have the team stay at the Eldridge Hotel before the game. So they would just hang out at the hotel, eat a light meal. It was kind of a thing just to set their mind right before the big game. Well, the Eldridge was segregated. So Maurice could not stay there with the team. He had to stay the day with a black family on the north side of Lawrence. And this scene is about, this is in the film. It is right after they've played SMU, and when KU with Wilt played SMU, they barely got out of there alive. I mean, SMU in Texas, they came after them. And Fog Allen is no longer the coach. I won't give all that away in case you see the film. But he has Wilt over to the house, and they talk about this thing we're talking about now.
Word to the wise, Wilton. Marry a good cook.
Enjoy.
So, I hear you boys had a hard time down at SMU. Yeah, we went down there last year. Maurice had to stay with the colored family. I always had the team stay at the Eldridge Hotel the night before a home game. Maurice was never able to be a part of that. He wasn't permitted to stay with us because, you know, the restrictions. I never knew how Maurice must have felt about that, not being able to be with the team, to be a part of that special time with the other boys. I just never considered it. Somewhere along the line, something strange happens. You become this other person. The legendary coach, Dr. Forrest C. Fogow. And this other fella, he's someone outside of you, but he's supposed to be you. But I tell you, he's a lot more fun than you've ever been. He's clever and charming. Always up, never down. Always good for a laugh, a story. I tell you, he's a lot more popular than you've ever been. I think Coach Harp understands that. Dick knows that it's about more than numbers and stats and who's best and winning and losing. He will never let his other fella take over him. You know why I'm telling you this, Wilton? You will.
So the whole thing that was really interesting about making Jayhawkers was that, you know, like that scene, the scene here where they're talking about how the Eldridge Hotel worked. One of the players that was on the team with Will told me that they didn't know Maurice wasn't at the hotel with them. That they didn't know that he was not there. In a sense, Maurice was like an invisible man. You know, that he, even though he was this key part of the team, he was one of the stars of the team. They didn't know that he couldn't stay at the Eldridge Hotel with the rest of the team. And that's kind of how segregation worked in this part of the country and in this area, was that, you know, blacks could not go inside, but they could get served in a sack. It's like to go. And things like that. And people, you know, so many people have come to me after the film. They said, I didn't really realize that's how it was in Lawrence at the time. And their grandmother or grandfather would say, yeah, I remember that a little bit, you know? And they were looking right at it and didn't see it. And that's the whole thing I try to do with my films. I try to make the invisible visible. I try to make things that we look at every day and we don't really kind of connect with them in all the ways that we probably should. And we, all of us do this, not just white folks, black folks, everybody does this. And we see these things that are often wrong and we don't really quite kind of recognize them for what they are. Want to show you a clip from another film I made. As I told you, my father was an old man when I was born. And when President Obama...
Our meeting today is the culmination of 5 years of research and rigorous debate. Dr. Butler will now reveal the final...
When President Obama was elected, it really made you think about, you know, the conversations you had as a kid, usually on the basketball court, and you'd be playing ball, and you start talking about, well, you think there's ever going to be a black president? And the joke was always, yeah, man, he'd be dead the next day. And we'd all laugh, and we'd, you know. But that was always what we thought. That was just a given that there would never be one, and if there was one, he would be dead the next day. And why did we believe that? Well, you know, there was John F. Kennedy. He kind of liked black folks. He got killed. And there was Robert F. Kennedy. He kind of liked black folks. He got killed. Then there was, you know, Martin Luther King. He got killed. There was Medgar Evers. He got killed. There was Malcolm X. He got killed. So there was everything in our experience told us that this would probably never happen. And if it did happen, you know, ain't going to happen. So I thought my parents had passed away, but I thought if my parents had been alive to see President Obama, you know, that was, it kind of made me assess how far we've come and how far we still need to go. And I thought, what kind of movie could I make on a very limited budget? $5,000 I made this film for. I'm very proud of that. What kind of film could I make that could kind of really illustrate how far we've come and how far we still need to go? And I thought, what would happen if black folks in 1939, dealing with the Negro problem, they all got together and had a secret meeting. George Washington Carver created a rocket fuel with the peanut and the sweet potato, and they decided to go to Mars. They're going to colonize Mars for black folks. Dr. Carver creates a rocket fuel with the peanut and the sweet potato. They make plans to go. Three astronauts are going to go. And I called the film Destination Planet Negro. And the problem is they go to colonize Mars, but they go through some kind of time thing, and they end up here today with a black president. Let me show you a clip of the film.
Our meeting today is the culmination of 5 years of research and rigorous debate. Dr. Butler will now reveal the findings of the task force to the committee. Dr. Butler.
Thank you, Dr. Humphrey. This committee is composed of the greatest minds within the colored community. Our charge was to find a solution to the Negro problem and present it to this committee. After years of relentless work and deliberation, this is our conclusion. We cannot fight them. We cannot work or live with them. Our only solution is to leave.
So I take it that you are talking about a new Back to Africa movement. Oh.
Yes. Well, we could complete what Marcus Garvey started.
That's right. No, Dr. Bethune, we felt that Africa has the same problems that we have here. Colonialism, Jim Crow, poverty, the feeling of inferiority. We must go further.
I take the task force has suggested that we join the Communist Party.
You'd like that, wouldn't you, Du Bois?
I, sir, am no red
as well. I will not participate in any conclusions that do not include my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Please, communism is not the answer.
Then where? Europe?
Become expatriates. Many of our jazz musicians have told us how they feel more welcome in Europe.
Europe is not the answer for the Negro. Yes, we'll be tolerated there, but we are not Europeans. We are Africans. And as our numbers grow, there will be problems.
Then where? There is no place else. The North Pole?
The North Pole is not a home for colored people. Matthew Hinson will tell you that.
Well, how about the South Pole?
Warmer there.
No. The poles are not the answer. We must go even further.
There is no further. What could be further?
Follow me.
So they take off and they find out that, you know, that the future is got guys with sagging pants. What's that all about? And the future is, you know, a lot of weird stuff. And they are, you know, they kind of see how great they have it now, but they see also the problems that we're still dealing with in various ways. This film, I'll do my little shtick here, this film is on Amazon Prime, so you can catch this film on Amazon Prime. The last movie I want to show you a clip from is Chirac. As I mentioned earlier, that I was in a play at Marymount College a long time ago called Lysistrata. And Lysistrata is an ancient Greek play written by Aristophanes in 411 BC. That's before baby Jesus, yo. And in this play, the women are sick of the men fighting war all the time. And they're so sick of it, they decide, well, what can we do to stop these men from going to war? And they decide to go on a sex strike. So the women go on a sex strike to make the men put down the weapons, put down the war ideas. And I thought, when I was in the play, the language of the play, Aristophanes, 411 BC, the language of the play reminded me so much of black slang, of African-American slang, and of spoken word and rap and all these things. And so I said to myself, I'm going to take that play, and I'm going to set it today, and I'm going to deal with gang violence. And so I wrote the play, wrote it into a screenplay, adapted it into a screenplay, called it Gotta Give It Up. And when I made CSA, I met Spike. I'll tell you a little quick Hollywood story. So I made CSA, and I showed it to my agent. My agent said, so what do you want me to do with this? And the next week, I got into Sundance. He called me and said, Kevin, you're a genius. That's how it works in Hollywood. And so he said, Spike was in the other day. He'd heard about your film. He'd like to see your film. So he saw CSA, and then he presented it. So it's presented by Spike Lee. And at that time, he asked me, what other scripts do I have? And I said, well, I've got this script called Gotta Give It Up. So we tried to get Gotta Give It Up made about 15 years ago. We had meetings all over Hollywood, had two readings for DreamWorks. At that time, Jennifer Lopez was going to be Lysistrata in the film, but it didn't work out. So about 2 years ago, Spike called me up and he said, do you still have that script? I said, yeah, I still got it. He said, let's set it in Chicago and call it Chirac. So I rewrote the script. We went to Chicago. We met with Father Michael Flager of St. Sabina Church. And Father Flager, Roman Catholic priest, been deeply, deeply, deeply involved with the gun violence in Chicago, trying to stop gangs from killing one another. We met with, we set up shop in Inglewood, the Inglewood section of Chicago, which is probably the roughest section of Chicago. That's where Father Flager has his church. And we went with several groups. We met with gang leaders, gang members. We met with former gang members. We met with a group of women, mothers, called Purpose Over Pain. And they are women, mothers mainly, that have lost children to gun violence. And so we really embraced the whole Chicago Chirac situation. And if you don't know, it's called Chirac because more people have died in Iraq and Afghanistan combined, U.S. soldiers, more of them have died there more people have died in Chicago than soldiers in Iraq and Afghanistan. More people are dying in Chicago right now than in New York and L.A. combined. It's just an amazing statistic. And so we made this film to really kind of try to address this. Let me go ahead and show you. This is the trailer to the film.
This is an emergency. This is an emergency.
Homicides in Chicago, Illinois have surpassed the death toll of American Special Forces in Iraq.
Hey, Dolomites.
Welcome to Chirac.
Chirac, where we at, my city?
Land of pain, misery, and strife.
Everybody here got a man banging and slanging, fighting for the flag, risking that long zip of the cadaver bag.
All to the bang, bang.
Bang, bang.
It all started with a gorgeous Nubian sister.
What's up, Spinner?
They call her Lysistrata. A woman like no other.
You just try taking away their guns.
Okay, the dirty poppers.
Because my gun go boom, I'll make sure a Trojan end up in the neck.
All right. Well, what else do they love?
Repeat after me. I will deny all rights of access or entrance.
I will deny all rights of access or entrance.
Listen, Stride, I had them all take a solemn oath.
Lock it up! Lock it up!
Stop the murder madness, or there would be no more Pope.
The situation's out of control, because I'm in front of an empty stripper pole.
Back. That's right. You get snubbed.
Oh, snap!
We gon' make sure these fools put down these guns.
Police sign, every day. People dying, every day. Mama's crying, every day. Father's trying, every day. Trying to get my head straight. It's the city of Chirac, man, get your bed made.
Do you want justice?
Please pray for my city. Too much hate in my city. Too many heartaches in my city. But I got faith in my city. This Chirac and I love that. You can't take away from my city. Some can't relate to my city. They die every day in my city, yeah.
I'm going to get a story of
facts. Can't shoot so babies get whacked.
Side is in Chirac. And y'all mad cause I don't call it Chicago. But I don't live in Chicago. Boy, I live in Chirac.
Peace. This is an emergency.
I don't know if we've got maybe a couple minutes here for a question or so. Yes, ma'am.
What's your next project?
I've got two movies I'm kind of working on right now. One is I'm writing a film for Amazon about a gay baseball player in the 70s, true story. He was a black, a gay player that played for the Dodgers. His name was Glenn Burke. And he was, he had to live a double life to play baseball, obviously because he was gay. And he's also the guy that was the first guy to do the high five. He invented the high five. Yeah, it's a really great story. And then, a few years ago, I wrote a screenplay about what would happen if Joe McCarthy, Senator Joe McCarthy, had become president. And when I started making the film, I said to myself, I don't think people will understand this because, you know, people don't know history, but I think they'll get it now. So, thank you guys very much.